Hello everyone, this is the Queen Bee coming at you, and I noticed in my video demographics that a lot of people from Poland and Russia are watching, so that was just my way of saying hi to them. I will try and pronounce it better, or pronounce it next time. So here are my tools. I've got a nice like distance on the camera so that hopefully this time we'll be able to have better vision of what's going on. So I've got flat nose pliers, my favorite chain nose pliers, flush cutters, and round nose nylon jaws. And later I'll use flat nose nylon jaw. And of course, I will be using 20 gauge copper, which you can find at Monster Slayer, and 26 gauge weaving wire, also from Monster Slayer. And to start my crystal point wrap, I'm going to need a crystal point. So I decided to take a break from the plain aventurine ones and use a rougher piece of stone. It is a green quartz that's been coated in an aura coating. It's also drilled, as you can tell. I'll be using one of the smaller pieces from my strand. Been dying to use one of these, so today was as good as any. So I'm just going to tie that up and put that away. I will incorporate other things as we go along, but this is kind of the foundation piece. I usually start that way with one thing and build from that. And I had no plans about what to do with this. I had no idea what it was going to look like at all. So I'm just going to cut some long pieces of 20 gauge. I cut up three lengths and they were about a foot and a half, close to 2 feet each. They were very long, but that's okay because it all gets used in the end. And I started weaving with just two of the three wires. And then later on you'll see I'll add a fourth length that's shorter. And you'll see why. But again, a lot of this video is me trying to figure out what to do. And I had a sort of concept in my head, but I didn't really know how I was going to accomplish it or if it was going to be how this turned out at all. So, but I like the way the final result came together. That was good. So in the beginning, I tried weaving a weave with the three base wires, but it just wasn't what I wanted. Didn't look the way I wanted it to, and it was frustrating. Especially because those things were mighty long. So, as you can see, I can't even fit it all in one frame. They were long. And here we go. I'm just going to start a wrap. It's mostly going to be the two lower wires, the wires that are closer to me. Thank you. Okay, so you can see I've gone to using the two lengths of base wire, because that third was not gonna be what I wanted it to be. So I will show you shortly what the weave looks like. It was taking all I had to not work hard in the wire too much, going around everything and over everything. But I will take the opportunity to thank everybody for watching and having and viewing all these Heidi wraps. It's really nice and inspirational to see that, and I'm very grateful. I know I should say that more often, so forgive me. Sometimes I forget. Okay, finally you get to see what I was doing. There we go. So one wrap around one wire and then three around the other wires. And that was a good connection. So I did that a bunch of times, and I'm taking the third length of wire now, and I slid the crystal on it. And there's that weave I was working on so hard before. And it is gonna go around. It'll go around the crystal. But you'll see at this point, I was like, what am I gonna do? I don't know. Sometimes it's like deciding what to wear. You just never know what your stone is supposed to look like at the end. Okay. So I'm just compressing that weave so it's nice and tight. Looks good. It's sturdy and it's got those openings, which are great for weaving in and out of if you need to in later on. It's all about leaving yourselves options when you decide how you want to wrap your wires together. So I finally kind of came to a conclusion that I wanted to wrap and make like a bead end cap kind of a thing with this, and this is happening on the end of the crystal that is not drilled. It's strictly ornamental. I got the inspiration for this from seeing a picture of a Heidi wrapped crystal point on Pinterest, and it looked like a circle, and this crystal point was caught in the middle of it on a diagonal. It looked really, really pretty. But mine didn't turn out that way, and I could see it not going in that direction, and instead of like fretting over it, I just kind of decided, oh well, that's fine. I can try that, you know, that approach again next time, and hopefully it'll work. So there you go, I made like a little coil there. And the wires at the top, the shorter wires, tail wires are going to be the bail at the very, very end. You will see. Okay. Here I am, kind of sped up a little bit here. A lot of these videos, I have to speed them up or they'll just be way too long. I've heard from some people that they like a long video just to see the process, which is cool because then I don't have to edit as much out if you like them long. It's just that I don't want to be too time consuming. This wrap, by the way, in real life, this wrap took about, what did it take? 2 days? I think I did it in a couple of days. I find that if I stare at the wire too long, then I'm just not as inspired and it shows in the work. So when I get to that point, I recognize that and I just stop for the day. So I'm working on a different wrap here. It's the old 3x3. So three on the two lower wires and three rounds on the top two. It looks really nice. It's nice and sturdy. And it gives me that density that I like. I really like the wire weaving to be prominent. Especially in heaty wrapping, that's a good idea because it will give you lots and lots of structure and you'll find you have more design opportunities. So here's that fourth length of wire I mentioned earlier. It's not as long as the other ones. It's about 6 or 7 inches. Because I wanted it to... I don't know, I just wanted an extra wire there in case I wanted to do something really, really strictly ornamental or if I wanted to add something structural. And I was not sure at this point. So I'm just continuing to do that same wrap, only I'm doing it with four wires. That's what I'm trying to say, instead of three. There we go. So we're just including that fourth wire. And it's working just fine. I find them the same way when I quilt. Some of you may not know, but I also quilt. And I've just been really focusing on my YouTube channel these days, so I haven't had the time to piece quilts like I used to. But I'm the same way. I really like to have a density with the stitching that holds everything together, which is known as quilting, because I just love thread. There we go. So, I'm just seeing how this is all fitting together, and this is when I wanted it to be a round sort of setting, I guess. I don't know. For the crystal point. So I was trying to, you see I'm tracing with my finger, trying to see the path that the wire should take before I actually commit to bending it. And I'm just bending that innermost piece of wire just so that I know kind of where it needs to bend to fit through the hole, because that's the side that's drilled, as you may recall. The other side is not. It's just I'm just holding it there. Okay, so I'm really, really going fast here. Sped myself way up. I'm going to... I've just increased the wrap and how much I had on the wires so that it will meet that point where it needs to bend into the hole. So I'm just going to head on through the drilled part of this bead here. There we go. Boom. And I'm just pulling it out and seeing what to do with it and how to make it incorporate into the wrap a little nicer so it's not like a sore thumb. My goal with this piece was to make it look like a non-drilled piece of quartz that was just floating. So I'm gradually tightening things. I don't like to tighten a lot at first because it... well, you can break things and whatever, and that's no fun. So I've got that extra length of wire there that I'm reserving for later. So I've got this, like, C shape of wire. And I was gonna try and make a bail with it. So that's why I have that blue marker. So I was gonna wrap that that C of wire and make like kind of a cool looking bail with it. But it just I didn't like it. It just wasn't working for me. If you can make that work for you, that's awesome. I was inspired by a picture that a Russian wire weaver had posted on Pinterest, so I wanted to see if I could do it, but it just didn't look right to me. So I end up with this like M now. It looks like an M. But it actually works in my favor in the design that I ended up with, which is cool. So I'm just taking a longer length of wire and passing it through that M. And just coiling it in between the wrapped or woven wires to make it look a little bit more, have more visual texture. There we go. And I'm just kind of messing around, clamping things down, and like I say, gradually tightening everything so that it will fit in the end. Okay, so I've worked out a wrap here for the four lengths of wire that I've got. I believe I'm doing three on the three lower wires and then one or two big loops around the whole all of them. The whole all of them. I wish I could talk. See that again. As you can see, I like changing my weaves a lot because it looks more interesting to me, and you can achieve a lot of visual texture without having to have a ton of specialty, what I call, think of as novelty or specialty wires. A lot of Heidi wrappers have square wire and half round wire and twisted wire and all these special wires, which are great. If you have them, use them. That's awesome. But I don't. I tend to just use round stuff because it's cheaper for one, and it's just more available in larger quantities because it's just the conventional wire. So, I mean, on my next shopping excursion to online to Monster Slayer, I might get one or two fancy things, but mostly it's just round copper. So I'm cutting my weaving wire off now and pinching the end. Because I need to do other stuff with the long wires. And I can't have the weaving wire on them anymore. So I'm passing. I think I pass all of those lengths of wire through that little channel I made that was supposed to be a bale at one time. And that's how I move the wires around to be going the correct direction that I want them to go. Pull, pull, pull. Okay, so these are chrysolite satin bicones, Swarovski bicones, 4 mil, and these are 12 millimeter ultralime Rivolis. They are also a Swarovski crystal. These are conventionally used in bead weaving. And as any of you know, if you've looked around my channel a bit, you'll see that I've done a lot of bead weaving. So I have a lot of those kinds of things that are beads. And I've always wanted to try and incorporate them into wire wrapping because I've kind of discovered that about myself, that I'm a more creative wire wrapper than bead weaver, in my opinion. So I'm going to use those things, because basically the Rivoli is like a glass crystal cabochon. It's just they've got a bit of a pitch to them, like they're not flat on the back. And those ones were neon. They call them ultralime because they put an aftermarket coating on them to make them green, like super ultra bright green like that. But I think it looked really good with this crystal being bright green. There we go. Just cutting that weaving wire off because I don't need it. you'll see I pulled a little heady trick, and I wrapped the weaving wire that I was working with around my finger a couple of times so that I could make like a little back for my rivoli, and that's how it stays in there. So that's what I'm wrapping through right now is these loops of weaving wire that I made. So I'm just seeing, I'm making like a basket, and I'm seeing how this rivoli will fit. It's only 12 millimeters, so it's not a big one. And I just really want to be sure that it is secure. And it will be. That's a mandrel for making jump rings in actuality, but I was using it to measure kind of how big I needed that loop of wire to be for the point at the back of the rivoli to sit through so that it sits nice and flat in the basket. So I just made a coil around that mandrel, and it's going to support the crystal. And there we go. There. So I'm just seeing how it's looking. As with any stone setting, it takes some fussing to get it to work, especially when it's small like that. Next time, I've got big crystals too, like big rivolis that I want to incorporate into something, but I don't know what yet. So at the moment, I'm doing a little weave of these two wires to connect them. They will go around the crystal. Just wrapping around the basket, and you'll see I eventually cut the weaving wire so that I can go through and in and out and all that stuff that you can't do when it's on the spool. I think I'm gonna cut it like any time here. Where would we be without our nylon jaw pliers, huh? Be lost. We would have loose weaves, oh no! So I'm just seeing how everything is looking and fitting and what I like, what I don't like. There it is, so far. So... I've cut my weaving wire. I've got the rivoli in the basket, and I'm holding onto it with my thumb and my middle finger so that it sits the way it's supposed to sit when I'm done. I find if I don't do that, then it will be, I'll weave things too tightly and then it'll sit kind of cockeyed, and we don't want that. It looks silly. But you'll see when I'm done. I'm just, right now I'm wrapping that weaving wire length around those weaving wires and kind of down and through to the back of the crystal setting so that it is solidly together. So yeah, this is definitely, in my opinion, I would consider this to be the trickiest part. Once you get something like this done, it's all downhill. It's straightforward. Nothing more complicated than that. And while I think of it, if you have any requests for stone shapes or something like that for me to wrap, do leave me a comment. I am happy to take requests. I love that. And because it's inspiring and it makes me have to think about a certain creative problem to solve, which I really like. So yeah, any requests are welcome. I have lots of different shapes of stone and different types too. I have lots of druzies, and I have lots of like teardrop shapes and fluorite in teardrops and triangles and circles I've got, and you know, rectangles, lots and lots of squares and rectangles. So I'm gonna probably do a series just on that, because there's so many ways you can work with those. And they're less common, so they make for a more interesting look. I'm all about creative ways of making things stand out. I like to make jewelry that when a woman wears it, they're happy, and it just kind of, I don't know, it kind of echoes that inner creativity and happiness that they have. And it's so great. It's such an amazing feeling to see someone wear your work. It's awesome. That Heidi piece you saw me do with the rose quartz and the pink aventurine, my friend who commissioned it got it just yesterday in the mail, and she was so excited. She sent me a picture of herself wearing it, and it is so cute. So cute on her. Perfect, perfect length and color and everything. It was great. Okay, so back to the crystal here. I'm taking the end of this weaving wire and I'm going through to the back, holding the crystal in place with my fingers, obviously, because it is not stable yet. It's getting there though. And I have to pull with my pliers sometimes because it's just too hard to weave through far enough a length that I can pull with my fingers. So here we go. Pull that through. And be careful, like if you get a kink like that, catch it as early as you see it so that you don't work hard in your wire too much. Because that's a shame. Because it will break. And as we know, broken wire is so sad. I'm just continuing to weave in and out and kind of back and forth through this basket so it is solidly connected to everything. I really, really always, I know that I'm kind of preachy about it, but structure is so important. You can make something look super pretty, but if it's not structurally sound, then, you know, there's no functionality in the piece, and then the wearer doesn't have a proper piece of jewelry anymore, and that's not a good thing, especially if you're making it to sell it and you have to ship it someplace. So if something breaks or comes apart, you can't easily get to it and fix it, and that is very, very sad indeed. So I consider it a part of customer service to provide as much structure as I can in my work. Because people remember that. We're getting things stable here. It's pretty darn near ready to be finished. I'm just seeing sort of what I want to do now with any remaining length or gaps or whatever. There we go. I'm just testing to see how it moves, if it moves. Alright. So as you can probably tell, this is a different day because it was cold. So I covered up. Right. And I'm just sort of tweaking that wire to make it round and not have any bends. And I'm adding some extra weaving to the back. Another thing about Rivoli is, especially when they've got those aftermarket coatings like this, is if it gets scratched from behind, the coating will come off and you will have a very ugly stripe down the back of your crystal, and that's a crying shame. You really don't want that. So that's why I'm working so hard on making a great big base. Okay, so there's that 4mm bicone, the chrysolite satin color. It's a more subdued green. It's a lot softer. Sorry about any ambient noise, you guys. I'm in the back bedroom where I don't usually record, and the cats like to sit on the bed and walk around and make noise. So. Alright. Supersonic speed. Woo! Anyway, as I was saying about that bicone, I used it to fill the gap that was between the crystal point and the rivoli. Nice quick way of doing it. Okay, so I am down at the bottom of the piece, and I've made a weave, and I'm going to make some curves, because why not? I kind of started the trend of the curve with the addition of the rivoli, so I thought, what the heck? Let's carry on with it. It provides a nice flourish at the end as well. So I'm taking the innermost wire and we're going to go up towards the crystal, like so. And I'm going to grab some watermelon jade. That's a bead in my hand. I think it's about 8 millimeters. 6 or 8, I can't remember. I don't have the bag anymore. And so I strung it onto the 20 gauge base wire, and I'm kind of wrapping it to stabilize it. And at that time, I didn't quite know what I wanted to do with it, if I wanted to just leave it like that or what. So I just kind of left that until I realized what I really wanted to do. But it looks really pretty, that kind of pinky color. Okay, so I'm gonna do some more weaving with my long weaving wire. This is still the same tail of weaving wire from way back. It's really cool if you can cut them long like that so that you can just go with it and not have to work off the spool. I'm just making some single loops. There we go. So I'm just weaving through all of them, making a V shape. Was my cat Sophia. That was her paw. That's one problem the wire weaver has, is their work is very enticing to cats. Okay, so I've strung on a really big, I think it's about 16 millimeters, really big vintage bead box bead. It's a glass, like milk glass, almost white bead. And I strung it on with the weaving wire. And I'm going to go through it a couple of times with the weaving wire and then once more, because the hole is really big. And then once more, I'm going to go through it with the 20 gauge because I really don't want that to move or break the wires or whatever because it's big and heavy. And I'm just wrapping single loops with my tail, my weaving wire tail, around the base wires so that it looks like one great big giant wire. It looks really cool. That's what I'm gonna do. So there I am going through the bead again after wrapping around the base wires a couple of times to stabilize myself. You will see. Go. But again, even with two passes, 26 gauge wire is still not ideal for a bead that size with a hole that big. Because I've found if you don't fill the holes in beads, then they wiggle and wobble and don't stop until they come off, and it's no bueno. Don't do that. So I'm taking one of the wires and I'm going to wrap it around the watermelon jade. You'll see here. Just for like a faux bezel kind of a look. I like doing that with the end of wire, just so that it's got a purpose. And it kind of secures the bead a little bit more, too. Shows how much I remember. Looks like I passed through that with the 26 gauge like three times. That's hilarious. I swear I made this just yesterday. I'm just. Just stabilizing everything. So you'll see in just a sec how this is turning out. So I've coiled around two lengths of wire around that white bead, and I'm just finishing right now wrapping the third length of wire that I had of base wire around that watermelon jade bead. And I'm just doing your regular old wire wrap around everything so that it does not move. Like so. And I had these two lengths of wire left over of copper, and I was like, what am I gonna do? I don't know. So I passed through the white bead with one of those 20 gauge pieces of wire because, like I said, fill your holes up. It will help them stay still and it will help them not break. Especially with that bead, though, those beads are heavy because they're old. And so the glass, for some reason, older glass beads are heavier and just sturdier, which is great, but it's just an extra challenge. And I'm just gonna wrap these two lengths around I'm just tweaking this to make it fit the bead tightly. Whoop. Just kind of work one wire at a time around, and it makes a really cute squiggly kind of effect. Apparently, I was clumsy that day. There we go. Okay, so I'm just figuring out the best way to get these wires around to the center right below the jade so that I can wrap them. And what's cool is that the look is a bit messy, so you can get away with a kind of a rustic wrap. It doesn't need to be perfect. It just needs to obviously not scratch people. That's what really matters. And I think that finished off the bottom of that pendant rather nicely. And it was completely improvised. I had no idea that that was going to happen. started so far. So now it's time to address the top and make an actual bail this time. Not a pretend one like I did at the very beginning. I'm just going to take the tail of the weaving wire and just kind of wrap it in just a second here. I'm just messing with it right now so that it stays put. You really don't want this to come up and off because, well, things will fall apart. And that's going to be the bail, so that's where some stress is going to be. So we want this to be secure. And I'm going to reach for another watermelon jade bead. They're so amazing. I love them. Okay, so I'm going to try to slide both wires through it, but they won't fit. You watch. So, I settled for one, and that's fine. So I'm going to take the second length and wrap it around, just like I did with that other one, and the white bead at the base. Go. And I'm going to take that jump ring mandrel in a second. You can also use bail making pliers too for the next step. It doesn't matter. Something cylindrical. I'm just using that mandrel there. And I'm just going to wrap a couple of times around to get a really quick, simple, sturdy bail made. And with the tail, I'm going to wrap it around like you would any other wrap. And tucking the wire away. So I thank you all for watching and subscribing and liking and commenting. I love comments, they're great. I do take them to heart. I do listen to your requests as best I can, and I try to improve as best I can. So I do hope if you like this series, you will, give it a thumbs up and subscribe to the channel if you haven't already, and yeah, do drop me a line if you have any requests for something new. And here's the final piece all done up. So you see, it took time, but it just takes simple weaves, simple techniques, but it looks like it was really complicated and hard to do, which is the bomb. So again, thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next video. Bye!